is all the way, baby. Yeah, Manure all the way.
One, two, three, four.
To any urban city, I can guarantee you, football is a very cohesive program.
Majority of the high school games, a big crowd.
Well, during those days, the stands were packed. In fact, I know at Woodson, you couldn't see everybody.
Everybody had their pocket of talent that, you know, and not only that, but they took pride in that area.
When I think about D.C. football, what really is special to me is that the excitement that you see in the kids' eyes.
We had so many athletes. I mean, we had so many athletes on all sports in the city of D.C. I don't know what was going on in Maryland and Virginia, because back in the day when you grew up in D.C., you never really left D.C.
We had our 3:30 games, and the students would leave the building and come right to the stadium.
Before we had the playoffs, it was dog eat dog.
During that time, the beast was in the East.
It was a time of change. May 1954. The highest court in the land had just handed down Brown versus Board of Education. Segregated public schools were no longer allowed. The landmark ruling, however, wasn't welcomed by everyone. Demonstrations opposing integrated schools were rampant and caused an uneasiness among many youth like Bob Hedden, a teenager at the time.
You had to be careful about the looking at the white people, stepping in front of them. You know, during that time, we had to sit in the back of the bus, and they say, well, everybody in your class, you gotta go to Western. I said, Western? Man, I ain't wanna go to school with no white folks, you know.
It was a sentiment ingrained in the minds of many as a result of years of racial tension between blacks and whites. One area in particular was Ground Zero.
When you try to go to Anacostia, and that's when you couldn't go across that Pennsylvania Bridge. During that time, you know, because the white boys had it locked up over in that area, you know. And when I used to tell the kids Southeast was white, they can't believe it.
Under that backdrop, the 1954 high school football season unfolded. The Supreme Court's ruling was handed down in May. Thus, there wasn't enough time to change schedules before the start of the season. So that season began like the ones before it. Black and white players would not compete against one another on the same field.
That's in old days, you'll say separate but equal.
Yeah.
But back in old days, it was not equal. Every high school, white high school in old days, had a sports complex, a football field, everything else.
But one day changed it all. As the 1954 campaign came to a close, city athletic administrators decided it was time. The season-ending All-Star game pitting public school players versus Catholic League powerhouse St. John's would include black players. Dave Harris, a tight end at Cardoza, was one of them.
South Hall pulled us all together, the black guys. And South Hall talked to us in this normal, demanding manner, and had all these guys he had never coached before from various high school, Armstrong, Phelps, Cardoza, Spingarn. We all came together and said, guys, we're entering into a new era. It's history. And I do expect everybody to carry themselves as good, strong sportsmen and be good, strong sportsmen. And we don't expect any difficulty as far as outright conflict is concerned. Because I want you to understand, this game will be watched carefully.
It was watched carefully. by thousands. The scene, Griffith Stadium.
Here we are in Griffith Stadium with the Redskins play and Cindy Udine in the sentence plate. And it's, you know, you look up at the stands, you see this large audience, much larger than you normally see at a normal high school football game.
That was probably one of the first times we ever went to Griffith Stadium and didn't sneak in. Wow. We didn't sneak in, you know, because, you know, we couldn't go there because during that time, back in the day, the black folks used to have to sit in the bleachers, you know, and the white folks had the regular stands, and they had a little section in the bleachers for the black folks, you know.
The drama of the affair was matched only by the drama of the game. St. John's led 7-6 late in the fourth quarter.
Sal Hall came to me and said, Dave, what I want you to do, use the speed here. I want you to take the defensive back, take him out, and then I want you to come back towards the corner.
Then, Dan Droz, a white tailback from Anacostia, swept wide and lofted a perfect halfback pass to Harris.
It was there, and I saw him, and I had to leap kind of hard to get it, but I brought it in.
Touchdown. Game over. The first integrated prep football game in DC sports history had been served a Hollywood ending.
It was just like Christmas, man. All the black folks were just happy, you know. And see, like I said, I lived up on, at that time, I was living on 17 Catalina Road. And we all up U Street. It was just like a big holiday, you know. Everybody, you know, glad that we won the game.
All I know is all my buddies, high school and off the block, they came out there in the middle of the field, grabbed me, and it was in the paper. They carried me off the field, up on their shoulders, and in my sports history, in my sports life, that was one of the greatest moments, being carried off the field by the guys you hung out with after school, around in the neighborhood, during the weekend in the neighborhood, you know. And that's where the game ended for me. I just carried me off the field. And a matter of fact, that was my birthday, December 4th, 1954.
Wow.
And matter of fact, I'm gonna tell you something. That didn't dawn on me until I noticed. I said, Dad, this was the day of my birthday. It never came out. That whole time, it never came out.
Harris was a hero. History had been made, truly one of the most significant days in district sports history.
We were the power. Let's say the 50s, even the early 60s.
And few places were as dominant as Cardoza. There's a reason Sal Hall's name is emblazoned everywhere at the school's football stadium.
He was the first person that anybody in any school or stadium was named after. He never raised his voice. Never raised his voice. I mean, he was quiet. And a gentleman, you know, well-respected and everything, you know, but he knew that football. And we used to call him Little Black Magic.
The little field general roamed the sidelines for 18 years, leading the Clerks to 8 undefeated seasons and a 6-year run that included an astounding 63 consecutive victories. There were other prevalent programs, too. One of the foremost existed in Capitol Hill, where the Eastern High Ramblers, led by Coach Dick Menzer, were building a powerhouse.
Me and my buddies, we 8, 9, 10 years old, and they would let us into the games as long as we promised that we were going to go to Eastern when we got out of junior high. But they had really great teams back in the late 50s and the early 60s, and really some great players. The joke in the neighborhood at the time was that the Eastern Ramblers could beat the Redskins.
A reputation well deserved. The Ramblers played in 6 consecutive city championships between 1958 and 1963, winning 4.
You won't believe this, Dave. I want you to get a shot across the street of that green field over there. See all that green artificial turf?
Yeah.
We used to call this the Dust Bowl. I mean, it was really, really dusty. And when we practice over there, dust will be everywhere. We come in like, everybody looked like a gray ghost when he came in.
That's Eddie Martin, better known as Flash, reminiscing about the good old days at Bell Vocational School.
The front of the school, actually, the front of the school was right here. This is where the front of the school was.
Really?
And it had a sign right there when you walk in the door, said, enter to learn, depart to serve.
The Vocats were led by Leo Miles, who was an All-American running back at Virginia State before returning to the district to coach, bringing with him quite a reputation.
Even more than tough, man. And you know what, them guys would be fighting, those big linebackers like Singletary and all those guys would be fighting. He would jump right in the middle of them, start thumping them, hit him with a forearm and stuff. Wasn't no child abuse back then, it was just getting you straight.
Leo Miles was scary and he looked scary. It's just his demeanor.
He was scary because I used to think he was a bully, really. I liked him, but I think it was a bully. You know, it takes a lot to scare me. The only things used to scare me was my parents and the good Lord. And I can't see the good Lord and my parents are gone. So that means now everybody's just like me.
In truth, there were very few like Flash, an elite running back who helped Bell ward off opponents like arch-rival Roosevelt.
But Roosevelt was our, I mean, man, they was on us every year. It was like, we got to get Roosevelt. Matter of fact, when we won the championship in 66, Reggie Washington, if he doesn't run a 45, 50-yard touchdown, we don't go to the championship. And this is in the fourth quarter. You know, and Tillerson has us by the throat.
The Vocats would go on to win three consecutive titles in the mid-60s. The era, however, would also provide one of the seminal moments of D.C. high school football history. Back then, the top public school met the top private school on Thanksgiving Day, a true city championship. Eastern and St. John's were the power programs of that era. In 1961, the Ramblers dominated St. John's in the championship 34-14 in front of a jam-packed house at RFK Stadium, setting the stage for an historic rematch a year later.
Well, it was. There were 50,000 people who were at that game, and they were clearly the two best teams in the city who were playing.
Former D.C. Mayor Vincent Gray was a youngster back then, a baseball athlete at Dunbar High School. He attended that Eastern St. John's rematch in 1962.
It really was the pinnacle in terms of high school football in the District of Columbia before and since.
The attendance, 50,000 plus, was the largest sports crowd in district history to that point. The game, however, would become infamous for what happened in the waning moments of the contest. A fight broke out late in the game, resulting in the ejection of an Eastern player. And after the game, racial tensions amongst fans boiled over.
It was a riot that occurred at the game. There was a lot of physical, you know, active. People got beat up at the game. There were priests and nuns who were beaten at the game. And my sense of it was that virtually none of it involved students of either school, that these were people who came to the game for whatever purposes they had there, and they really, they blew it. That game was discontinued after that. It might have gotten played maybe one more time, but it really was a moment in which high school football in this city could have been institutionalized. The championship game could have been institutionalized for decades, and it was simply ended. And we haven't had that kind of championship football game in the city since.
When discussing great coaches in district football history, the conversation always seems to begin with one man, Willie Stewart.
He was considered the godfather of the inner high.
Stewart's career began at Eastern. It was an unexpected opportunity, and Stewart didn't think he was ready.
The principal and Coach Johnson met with me and they wanted me to take over the head coaching job. This is like a week and a half before the start of football practice. And so I was like, you know, a little bit in shock. I always wanted to be a head coach, but I wasn't ready then, I didn't think.
It appeared he was right. His first season, a disappointing 3-7 finish.
So I was doubting myself, Dave, as a head football coach.
But it wouldn't take long for fortunes to change. In his next two seasons, Stewart's teams won back-to-back inter-high championships.
So all my doubters then became my biggest fans.
Isn't that the way it always works?
That's the way it works. Everyone loves winning. But when you lose alone.
It was the beginning of a hallowed career. Stewart would eventually move on to Anacostia High School, and the Indians would become a major force in the city for nearly the next two decades.
I grew up in Northwest. I call it Lower Northwest, right on the line on North Capitol Street, and in the Dunbar High School zone. And growing up, going to Terrell Junior High School at the time, we used to cut class, the seventh period, the last period of the day, on Fridays to go see Caneas Green play.
Green was one of DC's first virtuoso signal callers. Smart, slender, lightning in a bottle.
Friday afternoon was magical, and I was just so amazed that I was helping that to attract the popularity of football again.
Following his career, being excited about Dunbar football, the community football, seeing how the entire DC rallied behind, you know, Dunbar's Caneas Green.
Caneas Green, yeah. He beat me, I'll never forget, he beat me in a playoff game up at Wilson. And I asked Coach Banner, I said, where you get that boy from? He said, I had him all the time. He said, I sent him to camp. And it was a quarterback receiver camp New York. And from that point on, all of my quarterbacks went to that camp.
He was in the mold of RG3, and this is 35 years ago.
They called him Flamboyant at the time, because he was flamboyant. They called him Flam.
I used to wear little tassels on my socks and white shoes back at the time.
You know, we'd go out in the field after the games and imitate his dance, holding our hands up with the tassels on. And
so I got my flamboyant helmet on Matt first team. Couldn't take that to Ohio State when I left Dunbar. Coach Hayes wasn't going for that.
Green would go on to become the first African-American quarterback to start at Ohio State. And despite sharing the limelight with two-time Heisman Trophy winner Archie Griffin, it was Green who earned MVP honors in the 1974 Rose Bowl. The district has had many great football icons. Just to name a few, the seven Chesley brothers played at Anacostia and Eastern. All played college ball. Three went pro. Eastern's Mike Martin went to Illinois and spent seven seasons with the Cincinnati Bengals.
Horace Fleming from here at Wilson.
Horace Fleming is one of the most revered figures in the area. Known as DC Prep Football's longest tenured coach, Fleming roamed the sidelines at Wilson for 29 years, winning the city title in 1991.
Lonnie Perrin, that played at McKinley High School.
Lonnie Perrin was a dazzling running back for McKinley Tech. All-Met Player of the Year during the 1970-71 season, and he eventually played with three NFL teams, including Washington.
Michael Welcher went to the University of North Carolina.
Eastern's Mike Wilcher, all-ACC linebacker at North Carolina, before embarking on a nine-year NFL career.
Henderson Mosley, and it was a guy named Allen Johnson, who was a quarterback at Cadoza. Those are two best high school football players I've ever laid my eyes on in DC football.
Henderson Mosley. The quarterback was nicknamed Tater and was a dual sports star at H.D. Woodson before leading Central State Ohio to the NAIA Division I championship in 1990 and 92. He was also drafted by the Toronto Blue Jays. Coolidge's Jerry Porter. The wide receiver starred at West Virginia and then had a prosperous nine-year NFL career. Lavelle Pinckney was an unstoppable force for Anacostia. As big as a tight end, as fast as a wide receiver. He moved on to the University of Texas and then played 1 year in the NFL with the St. Louis Rams. No conversation about great DC football players is complete without mentioning Willie Wood. Wood played at Armstrong High School before eventually becoming the first African-American quarterback at USC and in the Pac-10 Conference. He was a two-time Super Bowl winning safety with the Packers and was named All-NFL 9 times. He was also bestowed the NFL's highest honor, inducted into the Hall of Fame in 1989. Wood was named head coach of the World Football League's Philadelphia Bell in 1973, becoming the first African-American head coach in professional football's modern era. He would also become the CFL's first black head coach in 1980. And in 2012, the district renamed a block of N Street in Northwest Willie Wood Way. From 1969 to 1994, James Tillerson was synonymous with Roosevelt Rough Riders football.
This is a poem I wrote called Do You Remember When? And these kids, you know, this was the thing that he would do cutaways. They would be in a push-up position, and he's called cutaway, and the hands would fly open, and the bellies had to hit the ground.
Believe it or not, when I first came out there, I thought the man was crazy. I really did. He would work those kids so hard.
He couldn't coach today because the players would be crying and going home.
We used to have a hill, and the majority of our practice was running. He used to take these kids to that hill, and they would run up and down that hill, 100-degree weather, 80, 90 kids out there, and he would just blow his whistle all day long. I'll never forget, I saw a kid run up that hill and jump the fence and just kept running and never came back. I mean, it was, but you know, he never cut a kid.
And his players executed his game plan masterfully.
We went to the championship in 73, 74, 76, 77, 79, 81, 84.
Tillerson's Rough Riders also lay claim to capturing the final city title game in 1974. A 41-7 thrashing of St. John's.
You can't help but know it, know about it, because it's Rough Rider law. Mm. It's history. I've seen the tape. That was a year Roosevelt had almost 74, 76 kids on the team. They had so many kids on the team that they didn't have enough helmets for all of them. And Ronnie Harris was a tailback, and Ronnie Harris was probably one of the best backs to come out of this city. They just torched St. John. It, to everybody's shock and amazement, because St. John had a pretty good squad. And of course, nobody gave Roosevelt credit at that time, but 41-7.
After that 74 season, the public school-private school title game was discontinued due to lack of sponsorship. The coach also had his famous sayings, Tillerson-isms, if you will.
Kill a fly with a sledgehammer. An empty wagon makes the most noise. Sometimes I used to think, what the hell is he talking about?
He was talking about football and life. And like so many coaches in the district, Tillerson did some of his best work off the field.
I know some kids, and I don't want to mention any names, who didn't have running water, who didn't have food. He had a locker in his office with coats, you know, for kids who didn't have enough coats to wear during the wintertime.
He talked it and he walked it, building a powerful program and, more importantly, turning young boys into men. The proximity of Roosevelt and Coolidge made for fierce competition between the schools. Add to it two great coaches, like the aforementioned Tillerson and Coolidge's Sam Taylor, and you had the perfect recipe for an intense rivalry.
Roosevelt and Coolidge had these classic rivalries. Sometimes they won, sometimes we won, so it was pretty much balanced.
Including a memorable showdown in the early 70s, when a pregame incident set the stage.
When Sam Taylor brought his kids into the school locker room, and Tillerson was trying to have, you know, his pregame, and they were banging on the lockers and screaming Roosevelt, you know.
They were fired up. That was the word. It was fired up. We fired up.
Coolidge coach Sam Taylor was often fired up. But he now resides in the peaceful hills of West Virginia. It's a far cry from the hustle and bustle of the district. But he still remembers that matchup with arch rival Roosevelt.
they stayed there. The first part of the game, it was all right. Then after a while, the reality set in. Mm. You know, the talent just overwhelmed us.
But the Colts won their share. In fact, four Inter-High championships between the 1970s and 80s, including back-to-back titles in 1985 and 86. Taylor says his players had the reputation of being mama's boys because some of them came from relatively well-to-do families. But what his opponents didn't know...
Well, that was good, too, because the mothers that we had were, like I say, tough. And that's why the kids were tough. That's what makes a difference.
When I talk to my kids and I tell them about D.C., I say, just look at the dot on the map. The entire map is huge. D.C. is that little dot.
Because the district is relatively small, there were many great rivalries in the city. And during the 1980s, a decision was made that impacted the competitive landscape.
Vincent Reed, who was the superintendent, he said, heck with it. We have trouble getting kids going to school. Let them go any place they want to go. And that's what happened. Started going any place they wanted to go.
And the rivalries took hold.
You're stopped by Ducky.
You know, it created these recruiting wars where these coaches, they're like the private school coaches. They're out recruiting eighth graders, seventh graders, and trying to get them all to come to their school. And you had kids crisscrossing the city.
You know, Coolidge and Wilson, we have these battle of upper Northwest.
For us in Southeast, it was always about the Southeast Championship. It was always about the Cup. That was Ballou versus Anacostia. We played each other. You could throw the records out the window. You know what I'm saying? We didn't like them. They didn't like us. But it was a mutual respect thing.
When I first got to Cadoz in 84, I guess our biggest rival was Coolidge.
Let me go back to when I was athletic director at Anacostia. When Woodson became a new school in the East, and that was a rivalry there, a natural rivalry. All of a sudden, this is the Tower of Power, a new school in the East, challenging Anacostia.
The proximity of Dunbar and McKinley Tech to each other. Roosevelt and Cardoza used to have the Battle of 13th Street.
Championships in the 1980s were dominated by three programs and their legendary coaches. Sam Taylor's Coolidge Colts won three, as did Bob Hedden's Woodson Warriors. Anacostia, under Willie Stewart, took home four. The battles on the gridiron were compelling and vibrant. However, there was a real-world assault happening off it.
To date, more than 1,700 people have been arrested in Operation Clean Sweep. Their apprehensions are putting a strain on an already overcrowded D.C. prison system.
Stand by a tree now. You got it ready? Yeah, let's move.
The crack epidemic was eating away at the district. Homicides peaked in the early 90s, and D.C. was given the infamous tag as the murder capital of the United States.
They were in the schools, they were on the corners, they were everywhere. And over there at Woodson, they had a little park back there, and that's where all of them were. And then we had a methadone center right there on the corner, Helen Allen Barrows and Sheriff Road. And all the junkies were there. They leave and go into the park.
In the 80s, the guns came in, the crack came in, and in the heroin, you know, they were finding people dead in the alleys.
Theophis Brooks ran the Youth Gang Task Force for D.C.'s school system from 1995 to 2001. He saw firsthand how the infiltration of drugs devastated district sports teams.
And a lot of football players didn't play football. You know, they were supposed to play football, but then for some reason, they want to get a car, they want girlfriends, or they want to start selling drugs and stuff.
Area coaches were winning games on the field, yet losing players to the drug game off it.
You had to make a lot of home visits. You know, you had to do it all. So it was, if you could coach in our old league, you could coach anywhere.
All our neighborhoods was, D.C. just was all projects. Pretty much it was all projects, and we didn't know no, to be honest with you, I didn't know no different because I didn't leave D.C., so I thought everywhere was like D.C. I thought it was projects everywhere.
I had to police my practice field because I found needles over there. You know, police would chase the guys that throw the needle over the fence. And I had to police the ground before we practiced. I had the guys to police the ground and said, don't pick nothing up in your hands, you know. If you see something, just tell me and I'll get it.
Despite the horror taking place on the streets, D.C. coaches were somehow still building winning programs. Two in particular, Bob Hedden and Willie Stewart, reigned supreme.
7 years from 1991 to 1997, Willie Stewart and Bob Hedden were competing for the championship on Thanksgiving Day.
Anytime you get the Godfather, Willie Stewart, and the Dean, Bob Hedden, anytime you get the two of them together, you can guarantee it's going to be a dogfight.
The thing about it with Willie and I, even though we used to battle and we were always good friends, yeah. And even right now. And that's something I can't say about some of these guys now that are coaching. Because I know we would play Friday evening, because the game was at 3:30 then, and Friday night, we'd be at a party together. You know, we'd be there, and the guys would know. The only time I didn't go to the party is when we lost.
And out of those years, Willie Stewart only won one. And he looked at me, he said, "Doc, what happened? You were my AD at Anacostia. When you come up to the central office, I can't win a turkey bowl." Bob Hedden was getting the best of him back then.
The Warriors and Indians staged many great battles, but 1993 stands out, a season characterized by both celebration and suffering.
My gunshot wound was so close, as you see, it was only, what, five or six inches away from my heart, so it would have blew my whole heart out.
Robert Smith was one of four Anacostia players shot during the season. One, Albert LaShawn Preston, was killed.
Of course, Coach Stewart made the announcement. We didn't know that he had passed away prior to. Coach Stewart didn't tell us until right before kickoff.
Really?
So, yeah, right before kickoff when we were in the pregame huddle. So
that
shook us. I mean, and it's like nobody wanted to play at that point. I mean, it was tough, man.
But Dave, my biggest problem was where Atlanta College is located. Southeast Washington, a lot of my players lived in public housing. And so they had to endure coming out of those public housing projects to school. And you know, with drugs being prevalent and homicides going on and what have you, you know, they had a lot to face.
The turmoil swirling around them didn't impact play on the field. Woodson and Anacostia dispatched opponent after opponent, setting up a highly anticipated regular season finale, which was won by the Warriors 24-22.
We knew we would see them again in the championship. Like, it was destined to happen.
Anderson was right. A few weeks later, the teams met again for the ultimate prize, the Turkey Bowl. The game was played at Howard University, and the stage was set for an epic rematch.
On our side was just filled up with people that were from Southeast DC. And their side was filled up from people that was from Northeast DC, and there was no empty seats up there.
It was cold, the coldest game I ever played.
The game didn't disappoint. In fact, four quarters weren't enough. It spilled into overtime, and the Indians took the lead. But then,
they got their possession, they scored a touchdown, and they got the 2-point conversion.
And bedlam ensued. The Warriors celebrated a city title, while Anacostia's whirlwind season came to a close.
Runner-ups again.
Considering what Anacostia had overcome, four players shot, one killed, just getting to the 93 championship was a feat in itself.
Coach, what do you have there?
That's the 1996 DCIAA championship.
Brings back memories.
It brings back memories.
If there was ever an unexpected champion, the 1996 Cardoza Clerks were it. Pitted against powerful Anacostia, Cardoza was the underdog.
You know, they had Atavius Cash, you know, who, and Sheik Pearson, a basketball player.
But Turkey Bowl mornings don't always go according to script.
It was one of the more exciting games you're going to see. It was you know, it's one of those games you get a rush kind of off being at.
I just remember that fight, those guys just battling out back and forth between two good coaches and two good football teams at that time.
You know what? That game still hurts to this day.
Anacostia was leading 32 to, let's say, 30.
They're 1 yard from the goal line.
Everybody's leaving. The entire Cardoza, Uptown, 14th Street, all that, 14th and Clifton, the whole 14th and Clifton's leaving. Everybody's gone. They're out the stadium. The game's over.
Instead of taking a knee to run the clock out, they tried to score. And they fumbled. I don't know who the guy who fumbled. May have been Cato June. I don't know.
All right, look, I'm gonna set the record straight today. This is what happened.
June says there were actually two fumbles. On first down, he appeared to be headed towards putting the game away when a Cardoza defender stripped him.
A guy literally hits the ball right on, hits me right on the ball. Boom. Ball literally stands on the goal line. Our offensive lineman, Ari Harrison, jumps on the ball.
Second down, second chance to put the clerks away.
So this is where the story gets a little flicked.
June claims the play was called for him. Only his backfield mate, a senior, wanted to score the game-winning touchdown and asked June to allow him to take the handoff instead. Confusion ensued.
His coach Stu is on the hash marks. Give it, I want Cato to run the play. I want Cato, get. The quarterback reverses out. The fullback, I don't know if he tried to take the ball from the quarterback or he hit the ball on the way to. All I know is I never received the ball on second down.
The clerks turned the Indians' monumental error into an historic drive, one that's still talked about today.
We got lucky and had like a 99-yard drive with a minute left.
And they score on a touchdown pass, and it was the kid's first catch all year.
And it was an upset. Cardoza was not supposed to beat Anacostia. Anacostia had beaten Cardoza during the regular season in a non-league game. And it was great. You could not believe it. It was like David beating Goliath.
Yeah, I was surprised because, like you said, Anacostia had the numbers, but it was all in the heart. The size of the heart that matters. And Cardoza, at that time, they had a bigger heart that day.
I remember going down into the locker room underneath Eastern and talking to some of the Anacostia kids, and they're just heartbroken.
And to this day, June is still trying to set the record straight.
And if your only person that keeps it real is Gregorio Cooper, who was our quarterback, he's the only one that tells the truth about this story. Everyone else in the world, I think even the dude put it on my wiki page. I'm like, dude. And I emailed him like, dude, that's not how it went. You know, because it's like, now I'm in my feelings. I'm in my feelings because I'm like, I did fumble on the one, I did. But second down, I didn't. I never got the ball.
High school football was alive and well. But by the late 90s, traditional D.C. public schools were fighting multiple battles off the field. Schools in border communities were growing and attracting district athletes.
Gaithersburg. Coach Haverhill at Gaithersburg. My friend used to be at Annandale. Bob Hardage. All the suburban schools started getting powers. They had better facilities, Dave. We had kids being recruited by the private schools, Catholic schools. I'm telling you, the coach who's now at, Good Counsel. Mm-hmm. I saw him at one of our junior high championships. He was recruiting our kids.
We used to travel with two buses. Mm. Because we didn't cut anybody. We used to keep everybody on the team. And plus, we had a JV.
Wow.
Plus, we had a JV. So that's to let you know what has happened in D.C. public.
To make matters worse, D.C.'s budget was constricting.
And that's when our school started going to West Virginia and Pennsylvania because they were giving us financial guarantees to help underwrite our programs. And only under the last few administrations, I give them accolades on that they've given money to the individual high schools to finance that.
Anacostia and Woodson continued their league dominance up through 1997. By then, Bob Hedden was unleashing a new weapon.
Bob was a receiver with the JV players, JV team. Somebody threw him a pass, and he caught it. And being lazy, he threw the ball back. instead of running it back to the quarterback. And I look, I said, who threw that pass? He said, Byron Leftwich. I say, throw him another one and tell him to throw it back. He did the exact same thing. And I called him up and said, come here, son, let me talk to you.
Under Hedden, Leftwich would become known as the Mad Bomber, despite Willie Stewart doing everything in his power to prevent it from happening.
Believe me, I tried all during his middle school days to get him to come with my youngest son Tyrone to Anacostia, but you know he lived in a woods neighborhood, and so he's a coach. I just can't see myself getting up all early.
I've known him. Like I said, I've been good friends with his son since, you know, we've been playing 10 and under, you know? So he always wanted me to come there. He's always, every time I see him, he always tell me, you wouldn't come play for me. You know, you wouldn't come play for me.
As a junior, Leftwich was hesitant to play quarterback. He wanted to play wide receiver, but after Coach Hedden's convincing, he tried it out.
Being a running back, I used to run the ball all the time. Yeah. I didn't throw the ball as much, but when I got Byron, that's when I started throwing the ball.
By the end of the 96 season, he was the starter. And by 1997, the hesitant kid had morphed into a confident leader, and Woodson took off.
Byron, a great player in the city, a guy that could really throw the football, raw talent.
We just wanted to win football games. You know, we wanted to beat everybody that stepped on the field with us. We wanted to make sure. I mean, we just didn't want to, 14-10, that wasn't good enough. I mean, we wanted to beat everybody that stepped on the field.
Chip on shoulder, absolutely. Leftwich says the Warriors were driven by the perception that they and the rest of D.C. were the have-nots, while Maryland and Virginia were the haves.
They really keep stats of us. We wasn't on TV. Friday nights, 10 o'clock, they had this little highlight show for they had high school. You wasn't seeing no D.C. schools in there. It was all Maryland and Virginia. So when you had an opportunity to play those schools, you wanted to put the big hand on them, you know? I never forget one time down HD, we played, it was like preseason, we played DeMatha. They came down there to HD and I don't think it was good for those guys that day.
Not good for DeMatha or many of the other opponents Woodson steamrolled that season, one which ended in the Turkey Bowl.
And I actually haven't been on this field since the, 97 Turkey Bowl? We actually was playing, Anacostia here too, on this field. And I was playing Tyrone Stewart has always been a good friend of mine, you know, so. And he was always the captain on Anacostia, and I was the captain on HD, and there's a lot of trash talking before those games. You know, there's a lot of trash talking to Cato.
You know, I got to say I love Byron Leftwich because, you know, in high school, every time we played him, he threw me the ball. I love Byron. He threw me the ball every time we played him.
You was going to have to play well to win that day. And it was going to be a battle. It was going to be a fight. And let's just say we won that fight that day.
The one time I lost to Woodson was in the championship my senior year, which was tough. It's a tough one, but I got him. I got him again. I got him again in a championship game. I should have got him and run it back. We might have won.
It was the end of a great era. H.D. Woodson and Anacostia would never meet for the city title again. By 1998, a new power was forming across town and was about to put the rest of the city in a stranglehold for the next decade.
After 97, starting in 98, the Big D came. The tide, the crimson tide of Dunbar.
The secret to our success, and no one really believes it, but it was really just hard work. And I think we outworked everybody at the time. We were on the cutting edge of doing 7-on-7s.
When I first got to Cadoza, for some reason, you know, we always had good success against Dunbar, but Coach Nunn, Coach Jeffries, they did such a good job putting that program together that after 4 or 5 years, there was nothing that we could do with them.
Most of our kids were fortunate enough to work in an ARE summer youth program. And our program was called Total Fitness. So as a part of Total Fitness, those guys had a chance to do some conditioning. They would run and lift, and we would talk about nutrition and hydration and all of those things, really before it got to be big issues.
The talent Jeffries produced became big issues for opponents. Aurelius Benn, Joshua Cribbs, Vontae Davis, all future NFL players. The Crimson Tide was rolling, and the rest of the league was helpless.
They won, I think it was 39 league games in a row that they won.
A streak that wasn't broken until Coolidge derailed them in 2005. Later that year, the stage was set for a Dunbar-Coolidge Turkey Bowl rematch.
That was a exciting game when Aurelius Benn caught a hitch pass and made a lot of guys miss and ran up the sideline, and we won the game. I remember that game as well. It was the same type of feeling where everything goes quiet and everything's in slow motion.
Craig Jeffries, you know, and Craig's a sharp guy, and he's never one to miss being able to get a little twist in when he can. You know, I mean, Craig's email is Jeff 4 in a row.
Yeah.
You know, because they won four league titles in a row at one point, and it became Jeff 4 in a row. And the joke was, is it going to become Jeff 5 in a row or Jeff 6 in a row?
When they had those great teams at Dunbar, we always managed to play them tough. Mm-hmm. One year, nobody had scored on them. We scored on them twice.
But of all the players Jeffries coached, one was the ultimate game changer.
Vernon Davis was one, definitely. He just was a phenomenal player.
He just showed up with all this paperwork in his hand and outran our entire team his first mile run. We gave the guys the mile run. He just sprinted around the track, you know, lapping everyone and laughing and smiling.
Man, I remember watching Vernon. Vernon looked like a man child when he was at Dunbar. I mean, he looked like he was on a whole different level altogether.
Davis was a supersized virtuoso, bigger and faster than everyone. He could run, catch, tackle, in a word, unstoppable.
When he played, you know, he could beat my team by itself.
So Craig Jeffries and Dunbar were the toasts of DC high school football. But other programs weren't just sitting around content to play second fiddle. One such place, Ballou. Ballou's coach at the time, Moses Ware, was cultivating a plan, one which had actually been hatched a few years prior when he was an assistant under Jason Lane at Coolidge.
We just start working and we just start saying, hey man, Dunbar's dominating this thing. We got to do some things a little bit different. If we seen Craig Jeffries doing some things with the NFL HSPD, we're going to do that.
Right.
If he has a job program to help keep his kids working out in the summertime, we're going to do that.
The Colts also instituted a fast break passing attack that was actually born during a Coolidge-Roosevelt game.
We got down like maybe 14-0, 19-0.
Yeah.
Oh, snap. What are you going to do now?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? 19-0. And we just decided, hey, man, as a coaching staff, we just said, hey, let's go no huddle the rest of the game. Mm-hmm. I really started seeing our kids enjoy playing this type of football.
Ware took that style of football to Ballou. His offensive tactics combined with Ward 8 talent was an explosive mixture. But his success didn't come without some criticism.
A lot of people feel I didn't, you know, pay my dues. Got tired of doing the political stuff.
Casting political correctness aside, the Knights rolled up opponents. And in 2006, Ware's team gained a reputation throughout the city.
Moses Ware did something I've never seen before. One year, he beat everybody. He beat H.D. Woodson, he beat Anacostia, and he was scoring 50 points on everybody. And Ballou won the championship. He destroyed everybody. And he called it the 50 Club, because everybody they faced 50 points.
We just laugh and joke. And I respect a lot of the coaches in the league. Don't get me wrong what I'm saying. But it used to be funny to me, like, it was okay for you to get blown out by Bob Hinton. I used to look at the coaches and I'd be like, look, they happy getting blown out by Bob, and it's okay to get blown out by Willie Stewart. But when somebody else do it, it's an issue.
Ballou's ascent set the stage for a Turkey Bowl showdown with Dunbar, who was still king of the hill. The game featured future NFL stars on both sides, like the Tide's Aurelius Benn, the Knights' Marvin Austin. Some say it's the greatest championship game in the history of the city.
Oh yeah, I know it was. That's number one, and number two was when we played H.D. Woodson, and H.D. Woodson beat us. Went back and forth. Neither team flinched. There was a mutual respect between both teams. Had a kid, DeJuan Thornton, I think he ran for 289 yards. Nate Bussey showed up. I was so glad when he graduated.
Indeed, Dunbar's Nate Bussey was phenomenal. And the seesaw affair wasn't decided until the final moment when Ballou picked off a late Dunbar pass.
It was the first championship in our school history, man. A lot of kids on both of those teams went to college. I challenge anybody to find that much talent on the field at one time.
By the late 2000s, H.D. Woodson was jumping back into the mix as well. And Greg Fuller was using a strategy similar to Ballou. Imitate Dunbar.
What we tried to do was at least mimic what they did and how they got there. And we just tried to build our program from getting to the championship based upon what he had established.
It worked. After a five-year hiatus from the Turkey Bowl, Woodson was back. And beginning in 2008, reeled off three consecutive titles.
The reason why that tie changed like that because of the type of athletes Woodson ended up getting. Well, Ricardo Young was one. Kayvon Spriggs is a good running back for me. There's a kid by the name of Alonzo Russell who's currently right now with Toledo.
And Tavon Wilson, who's currently a defensive back for the New England Patriots.
Over here, we prepared to beat Dunbar every year. Wow. Because, you know, we feel like that in the West, we feel like they was going to come from the West.
As the first decade of 2000 came to a close, the winds of change surrounding D.C. public school football were evident.
The ratio of citizens have changed. See, we had hubs of black communities. Now you don't have them now.
It was just a different place than it is now. You know, I mean, you can go to Anacostia subway station. You can go to Bennett Road, Capitol Heights subway station. You can go to any of these subway stations. And, you know, what shocked me, I must be honest, I was on East Capitol Street where I grew up at on 58. And it was 6:30 p.m. And I don't mean to say this way, but it was a white lady pushing a stroller on East Capitol Street at 6:30 p.m. That blew my mind. that blew my mind because
things they be a changing.
Yeah, I mean, it was different back then.
Recently, particularly in a neighborhood like where Cardoza is located, gentrification has hurt. When I first got to Cardoza, all of my athletes pretty much came from the surrounding neighborhood. And I would get generations of the same kids from the same family. Once families like those started moving out of the city, it kind of hurt our program.
James Tillerson, former coach at Theodore Roosevelt, never will forget when he said that one of the highlights of his coaching career was the year that he was able to suit up 100 players for his football team. And I think he accomplished that back in the late 70s, I want to say. Coaches now have to walk halls. And when they see kids, you know, that in the hall, they have to stop them in the hall and say, look, you know, have you played football before? You know, I need you to come out for the team.
You can see the change. I don't think it'll ever be the same because most of the blacks now live in Ward 9, what I say Ward 9, which is PG County. You know, they're moving that way. Rich or poor.
Demographics weren't the only change. In the fall of 2010, Natalie Randolph took over as head coach at Coolidge High School, becoming the first female in the history of the district to lead a varsity football program. And while Randolph humbly shunned the spotlight, she was viewed as a woman shattering a glass ceiling and received national attention. 2 years into her tenure, Randolph had the Colts in the city championship. And while Coolidge lost that day to Dunbar, the overall significance of the moment superseded football.
I'm proud of them, you know, no regrets. They left it all out on the field. We did a great job.
Public charter schools have become a force as well. For the past half decade, increases in enrollment have eclipsed those at traditional public schools.
Their enrollment was going up, so we started losing money because of our enrollment decline.
On the field, a shift as well. The dominant programs no longer had names like Dunbar or Woodson or Ballou. Those programs gave way to Friendship Collegiate Public Charter, which stood head and shoulders above the rest.
Great for our program. It's great for charter schools, period, that we're able to compete, you know, athletically as well as academically with everyone in the D.C.
But not everyone was happy. Claims of unfair rules favoring public charters were rampant.
Nobody's checking on them. Who do they send the eligibility to? We send ours to the athletic department. Who did they send theirs to?
If eligibility is done fairly across the board with us, the DCAA, and the charter schools, hey, nobody really has up and up. The up and up happens on the field. But when you can allow players to come from anywhere outside the DC area, Maryland, Virginia, whomever, and attend your school and play football or any particular sport they choose to play, now we're not playing on fair ground.
We've always submitted our paperwork to the sanctioning body, which for years was the DCIAA, until Clark Ray and his office, the DCSAA, came about, and then we submitted paperwork into them. Mm-hmm. Any questions that they ever had, we've addressed them, and we've been able to move forward.
They're developing, and they're getting kids in school. I'm not saying the academics are not bad or anything like that, but the rules have to be the same in athletics, you know. And when it first came out, I said, I'm not going to play them. When I was at H.G. Woodson, and I was AD the last 2 years when they came in, and I told none of my coaches we're not playing any charter schools.
Again, we were the new kid on the block. You know, starting back in 05, 06, when the athletic program really started to get going. And those teams did play us when they knew they had the advantage or they were the favorites. But as our program started to develop and get better, then the accusations came of us, you know, having older players, not having any kids with, you know, the academic standards or living outside the district. So it really just became an excuse, to be honest with you, because we were becoming a force in the city.
Moreover, many believed Friendship Collegiate illegally recruited players.
I bet they had at least 10 or 15 guys on their school, on their team, that were transferred from D.C., Maryland, and Virginia.
Every investigation or claim that's been made against Friendship, we have cooperated 100% with RC, with the DCIAA, and Clark Ray, and they found it not to be true.
On the field, it appeared the glory days of traditional D.C. public school football was waning. A public charter sat atop the totem pole, while traditional public school powers like Anacostia could barely field teams. Some schools like Spingarn closed down altogether.
People didn't want to play us because we don't know if they're going to show up or not.
The low point for proponents of traditional public schools had to be the inaugural state championship in 2012. That day, the top public charter, Friendship, thoroughly dominated the top traditional public school, Dunbar. And it wasn't even close.
It was a sad day for me because when I walked in there and I saw their lineup, I said, where in the world did they get all them big boys from? You know, because see, in D.C., with the middle schools, people generally know where the big guys are, what school are. And some of these guys I'd never even seen before, you know. And after I saw them running, they put that whipping on Dunbar, you know. I think it was 42-12, 6, something like that, yeah. And it could have been worse than that.
In 2012, a new athletic governing body called the State Athletic Association was formed, bringing all public schools under one umbrella and hence level the playing field.
At least on paper, we have to do things, you know, equally. You know what I mean? Like, and I think that's important because now at least we can hold one another accountable.
H.D. Woodson won the second annual state championship, a thorough defeat of Friendship.
I think it was great. You know, it was a great signal that Woodson sent to Friendship and let them know, hey, we're still here. We're still standing. Yeah, you built a powerhouse, but we still have to play. The results are done on the field.
But the question still remains, what does the future hold for public school football in D.C.? Clouds of controversy have often hung over traditional public school football and the city's premier event. The use of ineligible players and subsequent forfeitures seem to be part of the Turkey Bowl narrative as much as the game itself.
For starters, I mean, this was, it was, is, probably always will be a pretty small knit community. Everybody knows each other's secrets and their dirty laundry. Hmm. You know, and at some point, you know, when you think somebody else's dirty laundry is going to benefit you, you know, people pick up the phone, they type a little email or a letter. You know, you always wanted to outdo the other guy. Mm-hmm. You know, and it was personal, and it mattered. You know, you might lose, but if I knew you were playing your fifth year kid, you know, or somebody who didn't belong, yeah, I might turn you in. That's the way it was.
In the 80s and 90s, you know, it was an unwritten rule that once a kid was in your school, he was untouchable. I think it's changed today. You know, they raised the banner and raised the flag saying, well, I'm doing it for the kid, but it hurts the league and it hurts, you know, other teams and it hurts everybody.
Cato June considered himself part of a new breed of young coaches in the city who were working hard to change the district's reputation, building football programs in true grassroots fashion.
I'm telling you, walk the hallways and not only that, but prepare them, hey, you know, this is what you need. Academically, you know, we're not just waiting till August to see who shows up anymore. That day is over with.
Words like those conjure up memories of yesteryear when coaches like Willie Stewart were beacons of light in communities. They championed powerful teams, saved countless kids, and sent hundreds to college.
You had coaches who cared because you wanted the kids under your, not control, but under your influence.
I had one kid who played for me that lived in a shelter. And I used to carry him home every night with a couple other guys who I was carrying home, make sure they get home. And I would drop him off at McDonald's on New York Avenue. And the kid would say, Coach, why you drop him off at McDonald's? So he's going to work, man, he got a night job. He would go right at McDonald's, go in one door, go out the other door, and go into the shelter. This boy ended up getting a full scholarship at Howard University. Mm. So what I'm saying to you, the times were hard, it depended on the coach.
Stu is DC football in my opinion. I'm almost speechless when I think about, you know, how Stu has impacted me directly and, you know, in addition to all the other guys that play for him.
So moving forward, one can only wonder. If the glory days of traditional DC public school football have passed, will it ever return? It seems everybody's got an opinion on that.
Not a time hasn't passed. I can see it happening because changes are coming. And changes, we have to change as well as educators and as coaches.
I think it's on the way up. I see the, you know, the parity, you know, shifting.
No, mainly because the ratio of citizens have changed. See, we had hubs of black communities. Now you don't have them now.
Gentrification scares a lot of people because
it's change,
and there are people who are afraid that folks will be pushed out of the city as a result of this. We used to be 75% African American. We're about 48% African American at this stage. But the schools, you know, it's almost as if you could be returning to where the schools were many decades ago.
Schools like Friendship are continuing to grow and pulling numbers from the traditional DC public schools. So, yeah, it's only a matter of time before the charter schools start outnumbering the traditional public schools.
Turkey Bowl in D.C. Is not just the two high schools. It's a D.C. homecoming for all the high schools.
It's all about those kids. You could see their faces at the end of the game, receiving their awards, the championships.
It's Thanksgiving, really. It wasn't really about the food then. You was too young to care about turkey, macaroni and cheese, candy yams. You was really too young. And when you was in high school, all you wanted was to play that day.
When you get closer to Eastern High School, you see the RFK Stadium in the background.
Anybody that's ever played in the game or played DCIAA football is gonna take their time on Thursday morning, you know, of Thanksgiving and be there. to reminisce, you know, oh, when I played, and you know, and to cheer on who's the next crop of guys. And it's a great thing for the city, and it's a great thing for DCIAA.